Hello friends and welcome! Today I want to talk about this book, Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix. So as some of you may know, I've been doing these reviews because I am reading Harry Potter for the first time in English. I've read the entire book series multiple times in my own language, which is Dutch, but I never actually read them in English, and believe me, that's a very different experience. Also, I'm an adult now, so I have a different perspective. At least I hope so. That means that is also something different that I take with me while reading the Harry Potter book series. So I already did an entire video on Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire, and today we're going to discuss Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix. So I have a lot of sticky tabs, and that means I've learned about new spells, new creatures, new characters. Also, I have some theories, and I just really want to share them with you guys. I don't really want to address this, but I do because it's a thing now. The author, J.K. Rowling, let's not talk about her that much, but I do have my own opinion on the matter, so if you're interested, I will leave that video up in the info cards. But let's just pretend that Daniel Radcliffe wrote Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix, and let's discuss this book. And if you like these kind of videos, then don't forget to click that subscribe button and hit that bell so you never miss another video. F me again. Let's get started. I don't think there's anyone that would watch these kind of videos and don't know what the story of Harry Potter is, but just to be safe, this is book 5 in the Harry Potter book series, and Harry Potter goes back to Hogwarts. Lord Voldemort has returned and he is trying to get to Harry, and there is this secret order that was organized by Dumbledore, and then there's also the secret order that Harry organizes himself because there's a new headmaster at Hogwarts. I think that's kind of a good recap. Unlike the other 4 books, which I gave 5 stars, I gave this one, Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix, 4 stars. Some of the chapters were not really necessary, although I really like getting into more detail, but that could also be accomplished by just adding some sentences. And I just felt that it was a bit more slow paced than the other book, so sometimes I lost my attention a little bit. Nonetheless, still a great, great book, but for me it was a 4 star instead of a 5 star. First up is the spell section. So I'm gonna name a few spells and I'm gonna ask you guys to think about what they are or what they do. Honestly, I don't know the movement, I'm just doing something. Scourgify, Evanesco, Impedimenta, Flagrate. I will leave the explanation of these spells in my description down below, and let me know if you've got them all correct. Also in this book, we get introduced to legilimency, and that is the ability to extract feelings and memories from another person's mind. And of course, Harry Potter is taught this by Snape because Dumbledore is not able to, because of the connection between him and Voldemort. If you're a muggle, you can compare legilimency to mind reading. And to counter this, you need to learn occlumency, which is the art to close your mind. And in Harry Potter's case, it is to close his mind to the Dark Lord. We also get introduced to some new magical creatures. First up is the Doxy. Shiny, beetle-like wings, whirring, tiny needle-sharp teeth bared, its fairy-like body covered with thick black hair, and its 4 tiny fists cleansed with fury. I kind of imagine these Doxies to look like pixies, but then like the badass, tough version of pixies. And in the book, they catch them by spraying doxicide on them, so they freeze in mid-air, they fall on the ground, and then they put them in buckets. Sounds like a good time to me. And of course, the Thestrals, which are these winged horses with skeletal bodies. And although this is not the first time that they make an appearance in the Harry Potter books, it is the first time that Harry is able to see them and that the entire gang is flying out of Hogwarts on these Thestrals. The other people in the group, apart from Neville, can't see them, so they have to ride these invisible flying creatures, and I think that would be so scary, and I think it's just very funny to imagine someone flying on an invisible creature. So yeah, that is one of my favorite parts in the book with the Thestrals. Now, let's talk about characters. First up is Harry Potter. He can be really nasty. Like, in my mind, when I was a teenager, Harry Potter was like this angelic boy that was nice to everyone, but then I read Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix, and although he's talking to Dudley, I still think he's being very mean. So Harry says, "Running to Daddy now, are you? Is his equal boxing champ frightened of nasty Harry's wands? Not this brave at night, are you?" sneered Dudley. This is my Didikanes. That's what we call it when it goes all dark like this. I just thought Harry wasn't capable of being that mean, but apparently he is. And of course, we also get to know Luna Lovegood a little bit better in this book. I think it's just very fun to get to know her and to know more about her personality. And she's just such a fun and quirky character. And although we all know Luna and her lion headdress, in this book, she actually wears a live eagle. I totally forgot about that, but I vote for having Luna Lovegood in her eagle headdress. Then there's Ginny Weasley. And oh my gosh, Ginny is getting so sassy in this book. In the first four books, she was just a little girl that was tagging along. But in this book, you can really see her developments. She is being so like full on sassy. I absolutely love it. There are also some new additions to the Hogwarts staff. So, of course, we need to talk about Umbridge. I think it is just brilliant what the author did, because you really hate this woman with a passion. And I don't think I have ever read another book in which I hate a character so much. Like, Umbridge is just, there's nothing to love. She is like pure hatred and just evil and, oh, such a nasty woman. And you can really see the buildup of her character. So she starts as a teacher, then she needs to inspect other teachers for the ministry, then she becomes this high inquisitor, and then of course the headmaster of Hogwarts. And along the way, she comes up with all these impossible rules, and I think it's just really fun and pretty annoying to read about her buildup as a character. And of course, the best part is the end, where she is like taken down by all of the teachers, of course by Peeves, by Fred and George. Like, all the events that happen surrounding Umbridge is just so much fun to read. But what I forgot was that Professor Flitwick also stood up to Umbridge. So he says, "Thank you so much, Professor," said Professor Flitwick in his squeaky little voice. "I could have got rid of the sparklers myself, of course, but I wasn't sure whether or not I had the authority for it." I thought that was just so funny and like, And our new divination teacher, because Umbridge has sacked Professor Trelawney, so we get Firenze, a centaur who used to live in the Forbidden Forest. And I just think he's one of the coolest teachers. I would so love to have divination from a centaur, and just how they describe the classroom that they're in. Like, it's a forest with a clearing and they have to look up at the sky. It just sounds amazing, and I wish I could go to Hogwarts and follow a class with Firenze. And let's not forget Grob, because Grob is the little brother of Hagrid, and although Grob doesn't have a big part in the book, I still think he's an awesome character. And there's this part where he is in the forest and there's the centaurs that are there to do Harry Potter and Hermione and Umbridge harm, and then Grob comes along. It was what the centaurs have been waiting for. Grob's outstretched fingers were a foot from Harry when 50 arrows soared through the air at the giant, peppering his enormous face, causing him to howl with pain and rage, and straighten up, rubbing his face with his enormous hands, breaking off the arrow shafts, but forcing the arrowheads in still deeper. Like, this hurt me when I read about Grob. Like, I can see him doing this and then the arrows going deeper. Like, imagine that, like arrows in your face. It just sounds horrible. And I fell for Grob in this part. So yeah, just wanted to share that with you guys. And Dobby also makes an appearance in this book, and what is actually very cute is that he is gathering all the knitted hats that Hermione is making. She's staying up late, she's knitting these hats and socks and sweaters for these elves so that she can free them. But it is actually Dobby that is gathering all the clothes and is walking around with like 20 hats on top of each other. So I thought that was really cute. Two things that I've noticed about Hogwarts. So first of all, why isn't everyone obese? I mean, did you read what these kids eat there? They eat potatoes, bacon, apple pie. Like, all these foods that are high in calories. How is it that not everyone at Hogwarts is fat? Like, if I would eat that 3 times a day, I would be so big. It's not normal that these kids are not obese. So I don't know how these house elves do it, but I need some tips. And second of all, if you're a school of witchcraft and wizardry, how come it's always so freaking cold? Like, just get heaters. Do a spell that makes the castle warm. every time I read these books, I read about how cool it is at Hogwarts. Like, there's a sentence in this book that says that they need to wear dragon skin gloves just to keep their hands warm. I feel sad for those kids. I mean, come on, isn't there anyone in the entire wizarding world that can just cast a heating spell on Hogwarts? Something that caught my eye is one of the tapestries at Hogwarts, and it's the Barnabas the Barmaid's foolish attempt to train trolls for the ballet. I think that tapestry would look hilarious, and I think it is in a movie, but I'm not sure because it's been a while since I've watched the movies, but somebody should make a magical pin out of that. That would be amazing. The book also mentions Berufio's brain elixir. Meanwhile, a flourishing black market trade in aids to concentration, mental agility, and wakefulness had sprung up among the 5th and 7th years. Harry and Ron were much tempted by the bottle of Berufio's brain elixir offered to them by Ravenclaw's 6th year Eddie Carmichael, who swore it was solely responsible for the 9 outstanding owls he had gained the previous summer and was offering a whole pint for a mere 12 galleons. The reason I found that really fun to read about is because I actually have Berufio's brain elixir. I got it in one of my cauldron crates, and it just felt more real when I read about it in the book, knowing that I had a little bottle of it. You might have noticed this already in Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire, but Hermione really does read all her books, especially Hogwarts in history. So she knows all the rules of Hogwarts on the grounds, what you can do, what you can't do, and there's another example of that in Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix. This part is actually about why the girls can get into the boys' dormitories, but vice versa they can't, so boys can't get into the girls' dormitories. Well, it's an old-fashioned rule, said Hermione, who had just slid neatly onto a rock in front of them and was now getting to her feet, but it says in Hogwarts a history that the founders thought boys were less trustworthy than girls. I think the founders were really smart people. At one point, Harry, Ron, and Hermione are visiting St. Mungo's, and I don't know if I forgot this or just didn't read it with enough attention, but I never noticed that the entrance of St. Mungo is really something special. They had arrived outside a large, old-fashioned red brick department store called Perch and Douse. The place had a shabby, miserable air. The window displays consisted of a few chipped dummies with their wigs askew, standing at random and modeling fashions at least 10 years out of date. Large signs on all the dusty doors read, closed for refurbishment. And then there's this very ugly dummy that you can tell who you want to visit, so in this instance Arthur Weasley, and then you can just step through the glass and you're in St. Mungo's. And while there they meet Lockhart, who is a resident at St. Mungo's, still giving out autographs and talking about himself. Yeah, I thought that was just a really fun part to read. Then there's also the theories. So first up, why does Dumbledore show up unannounced on exactly the right time to defend Harry while he's at trial? I don't know, how does he do that? So there's one theory that he might have used the time turner to go back in time to be at the exact right moment to defend Harry. I'm not sure, or maybe he has this sixth sense of just knowing things. But yeah, I think he used a time turner because that would make the most sense. But I'm curious to hear your thoughts on that theory. And then there's the fact that nobody stops Umbridge. I really don't get it. I mean, she abuses the students. She comes up with all these rules and regulations. I don't know, it just feels like, I know that some teachers said something about it, but nobody really did something to stop her, apart from Fred and George and Peeves and people like that. But I don't really get it. I know she was protected by the ministry, but still, like, Dumbledore is a powerful man. Other people are powerful too in the wizarding world. So why did nobody try to stop her? And this last one I thought was really funny. I actually Googled this, but there's a theory that Hagrid is a Death Eater. And when you look back at all the books, especially apparently in Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix, he makes all these moves that really contribute to the rise of the Dark Lords. I don't see it, but if you guys do, then let me know in the comments down below, because that would be such a weird theory. And per usual, I also have some favorite quotes, and you might guess from who this quote is. The world isn't split into good people and Death Eaters. That is, of course, Sirius Black. And we all know the famous quote from Hermione, just because you've got the emotional rings of a teaspoon doesn't mean we all have. But there's actually another quote of hers on the previous page. You are the most insensitive wart I have ever had the misfortune to meet. They should put that quote on merchandise. Oh guys, and don't forget to enter my 1k giveaway. Once we reach 1000 subscribers, I'm going to choose a winner that gets a mystery box filled with bookish goodies, a book, and Harry Potter items. You really don't want to miss it. Go over to my Instagram. All the rules are over there. Check it out. And that was my book review of Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix. I have ordered Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince as well, so that will be here in 1 or 2 weeks, hopefully. I'm gonna add that to my TBR as soon as possible, and I'm going to do another book review video on that one because I just really like doing these videos. I really love discussing the books with you guys. I hope you enjoyed this video as well. If you did, then please give it a thumbs up. Thank you so much for watching, and let's stay in touch.